Okay, I've been sitting here for an hour recording the first two parts of this video series. Now is the finale to the three-part series on how to be a good YouTuber. This series was never about how to gain subscribers or gain views, it's about how to be a YouTuber and how to be a good YouTuber. Not just successful, but good. The first episode of this series was how to start being a YouTuber. The second episode of this series was how to continue doing YouTube videos. And this episode, the finale, is all about the next step, leaving your job for YouTube. Before I continue, I want to say a big thank you to the Patreon supporters and the YouTube members who are supporting this show. Wednesday is the first exclusive live stream for those of you who are a YouTube member and those of you who are donating $4 or more. It's exclusive to the Patreon supporters and the YouTube members only, 6 p.m. UK time. Be there or be square, because you're not around. Now I want to talk about Patreon as well. You may be in the situation in which you're thinking about leaving your job to do YouTube full time, which is great. Honestly, it is great. However, depending on the type of content that you make, I advise caution. Two reasons. One, you might not have enough money to sustain yourself full time. And two, you might not be making consistent money to sustain yourself full time. What I mean is, by having a creative job is very risky because YouTube doesn't pay very well. So you might be able to afford living by yourself somewhere with 1 month's paycheck, but because of the volatile nature that YouTube is, especially with the monetization process of it, you might have enough 1 month, but next month you might not even make half. It's okay if you're a young person living at home and you don't have to pay rent, you can focus a lot of time and energy to that. And if your parents are suggesting that you need to get a job, you need to sit down and talk to them. Explain that you want to try and be a content creator, and YouTube takes time and effort into making it big. Try and see if they'll be happy with you taking a year out and become a YouTube creator full time to see how well that will do for you. If it doesn't land well with your parents, then just get a job. Because your parents might be in a bad place financially, but to protect you and make you feel not upset or threatened about the situation that they're in, they might not tell you that they're struggling. And that's purely to make you feel more secure. So if they do agree to the year off, you have to put every effort that you have to make it work. If you have been given the opportunity by your parents to live at their house rent-free for an entire year whilst you work on YouTube projects, you have to make that work, because you will not get this opportunity ever again. A lot of the time they might not want you to actually get a job, they just want to see if you have any work ethic. And if that is the case, then you need to prove to them that you do have work ethic. If after a year it doesn't work, or if they are really pushy and they don't suggest you have a year off, just get a job and do two at the same time. Work out how much you need to give them each month and get a job that suits that, so you have the time to work on YouTube, if that is what you want to do. Just talk to your parents, it's easier. Show them this video if you need to. Patreon is a platform in which you can donate money towards a content creator who isn't making a lot of money or is making a creative project, like YouTube partners or musicians or painters or artists or novelists, things like that. Patreon is only as successful as you make it. However, Patreon for me has been very successful because I have had it for years now and it's been very good for me. However, you have to remember that what you put into your Patreon page is what you get out of your Patreon page. The incentives that you give the members of your audience have to be enough to warrant them actually donating money to you, but it has to be easy enough for you to handle so that you're not swamped with so much stuff to do on your Patreon page and your YouTube channel. Patreon is available for everyone who wants to sign up. So if you have one subscriber, you can sign up. If you have a million subscribers, you can sign up, which is a positive. The other option that you have is YouTube memberships. They have the added benefit of being integrated into YouTube itself, so you have other positive things, like occasionally in my comments you'll see a YouTube member who has their name highlighted and a badge of my logo next to them. That's to indicate that they are a member. It's a nice little incentive. You also get different badges for however long you're a member for. You get emojis that you have for your live streams. There's lots of different things. Perks. The downside is that you only have a single tier of donation, so you can't customize the donation options, but it doesn't mean that that's necessarily a bad thing. They might improve that in the future, just like how Twitch did it as well. Also, I think you need to be a YouTube partner, but this video is kind of tailored to those who have a large subscriber following and not sure what to do next. Either way, be it Patreon or YouTube memberships, you need to be consistent with the rewards that they get. and the value that they get from those rewards. Patreon integrates with Reddit and Discord, so you can use that to your advantage when you need to get to know your YouTube audience a bit better. So that goes well with the other part of this series that we talked about when it comes to discussing and getting to know your audience. I would suggest that Patreon pages should be only used by those who are actually struggling with money, or if you have something that you can give your YouTube audience that no one else can really give. I would say that it's best to have an incentive to your channel rather than just begging for money. For the longest time, I had lucid dreaming support, which is my niche. So I do lucid dreaming videos, so I gave people lucid dreaming guidance as a tier or a motivation towards becoming a Patreon supporter. I also did lots of other things. At the moment, I'm doing live streams and extra podcasts and stuff so that people can have that and your name's in the content itself. If you release a Patreon page too early, it may look negative on your behalf. It may look like you're just looking for a cash handout. So make sure you've got some kind of YouTube audience before you start a Patreon page. Most important thing is that you have to look after the YouTube audience on Patreon or the YouTube memberships. These aren't just your diehard fans. These are the diehards of the diehard fans. They trust you enough to give you money. Don't abuse that trust. Quitting your job. Now, quitting your job for YouTube is a difficult situation to talk about because there's so many different things that come into play. Is it the right call? Might be, might not be. Depends on the content that you make, depends on the situation that you're in. Every person is different. I've got a few things that I would advise before quitting your job for YouTube. Savings is one of them. You need to have a good amount of savings behind you. Keep your savings money in a separate account. Maybe you can use PayPal for this advantage. Have enough money to keep going for a year, just in case. Remember also that sometimes your equipment breaks. So for example, I saved up enough money for me to live for a year without going to work ever again. And in that time, I was working at a freelance job because I'm a freelance videographer. And whilst I was on the job, my camera broke. Luckily, I had a spare camera with me, but then I had to buy this camera, a replacement one, which wasn't cheap. Also, my audio equipment broke, or I had to upgrade it to this one because I do interviews as part of my freelance job as well. So I needed something that had a better audio. Also, I needed to get a new tripod. I actually had a lot of feedback from my freelance work saying that I needed something else. So I bought a DJI Ronin S for stability on my footage. That was an investment that turned out well, I'll tell you that. But you see my point. All the money that I saved up for the year has gone, pretty much. Even though you could see it as investment or you could see it as expenses that you needed to pay, either way, the money went quite quick. So save up and save up more than you think you need. Let's take an extreme example of that. Let's say you are a YouTuber who focuses on gaming. And all of a sudden your graphics card breaks. So you are making content that needs a graphics card in order to make it work effectively, and your graphics card just breaks and you need to shell out on another graphics card. That's gonna eat up your savings very fast. My other bit of advice is, do you need to leave your job? Can you do both at the same time? If you work well and have a successful YouTube channel, do you need to leave your work in order to do your YouTube channel, or is it just something that you feel like you wanna do? Again, an example of me. I was an assistant manager at a retail shop, and I worked there for nearly seven years. Instead of leaving my job, when my YouTube channel started taking off a little bit, I just stepped down from management role and I went to a normal working role. So I had my YouTube channel and I still had my consistent income from my job. I had less hours, I had less money, I had less commitments and less responsibilities, but I still had regular work and I could focus on YouTube more until the point it came where I did quit. I would only advise quitting your job if you knew that you were going to be fine financially. Also, I left my job on very good terms because if things pan out for the worst, I know that I've got somewhere that I can go back to and they would accept me. That's a good bit of advice. Good working relationship. Let's talk about content shifts and breaks. You are not a machine. You can work every day, all the days, for 10 years, but at some point, multiple times probably, you're gonna need a break to recharge your batteries. If you're in a financially good place, you could take some time off YouTube, no problem. And when you go back, you're refreshed. You feel better about the content you make and you make awesome, awesome content. Even if that means you just stop making as much content as you do, but you're still working behind the scenes, that's also good. I did the same thing. I was making a video every other day for God knows how long, and then I stopped making a video. And even though I wasn't creating content on YouTube, I was still working as a freelance videographer and editor and a YouTube consultant off screen. So I still worked, but it was just a different type of work. And that recharged my batteries and made me think, yeah, I kind of need to focus on YouTube right now. so I went back to it day after day. If you're making content which is stale, and trust me, I've been there, then you might be thinking about a content shift in which you make different type or different genre of content. Here's where you really need to think hard. My advice is to slow down and just think before you act. Is there a way that you can make fresh content? It's the same content, but it's done in a more fresh and vitalized way. If there is, maybe you should try that. If you really don't like the content that you've been making, then maybe it is time to do a shift. But first things first, what kind of shift do you want to make? Do you want to do a gradual shift, which has its benefits because people won't like automatically unsubscribe to you because there's not much of a backlash. But the negatives of that is that you still have to make the stale content that you don't like. The second thing you can do is just shift it straight away. But then you get a really bad backlash and a drop of subscribers. If your subscribers fall, that means maybe less people are watching your content, and if less people are watching your content, then that might mean that you're not making as much money on YouTube. This is something you've got to think about when you're toying the idea with leaving your job. But no matter what you do, you have to discuss this with your subscribers. You have to create a portal of communication, if that's through Discord or for Patreon or for your YouTube membership or whatever it is, through Twitter, you have to discuss it with someone because they will have a fresh perspective on what you're going through that you haven't really thought about. I have to do the last bits really quickly because the sun is setting because I've been sitting here for so long. So let's talk about falling subscriber count. Sometimes you'll have a drop of subscribers. It'll fall, it happens sometimes, but other times it can be quite consistent. As I mentioned before, maybe in this video or a different one, people don't always want to see your face every single day. And I recently went from making a video every other day to making no videos and then coming back with a video every single day. And I've noticed a massive drop in subscribers, but it was something I predicted because not many people want to see your face every single day. This month is the first month ever in my whole YouTube career that I have lost more subscribers than I have gained ever. And I've been on YouTube for over 11 years now. However, subscriber counts and how many you're making and how many you're losing isn't a good metric to track your growth on YouTube. I would advise going to your analytics screen, going to your watch time and your average view duration. If your subscriber count is going down, but those two metrics are still rising, then you're doing something well. That means you're losing the subscribers that don't really want to watch your content, but the people who are staying are watching your content, and those two metrics are rising up and up. As long as it continues to rise and your subscriber count is dropping, then it's fine. If it's leveling off a bit, but your subscriber count is leveling off, that's fine as well. But the best way is when that's going up and your subscriber count is going up. Perfect. If your subscriber count is going down and your watch time and your average view time is going down, then you're doing something bad and you need to really think about what you're doing. As long as people are enjoying watching more of your content for longer, YouTube will look after you because it's in their best interest to promote the channels that are making people watch their videos more. Because in a sense, you're making them money. Branding. I won't talk much about this because it's not in my area of expertise, but a good YouTuber makes good content for people. A successful YouTuber makes a brand and good content. YouTube may not be around forever. Think about all the websites that you were fanatic about in the day, and those have gone, like MySpace or Bebo or other websites that I can't think of right now. YouTube may not be here in the future, and you need to make a brand. When Casey Neistat started making videos, he used to wear his sunglasses so that when he was looking at the viewfinder, like I am now, you didn't see his eyes divert. Instead, you would just see sunglasses, and it would give the illusion of looking into the camera. Now, because that was part of his image, that created kind of like a brand for him. And now he has jewelry and logos all around him and his weird glasses. If you think about it, every single popular YouTuber has their own brand. Pick a YouTuber. Logan Paul has the Logang. Jake Paul has the Paulers. PewDiePie has his legendary bro fist. Jacksepticeye has his own septic eye. Jax Films has Be a Klondike. Everyone has something. Create a brand that will last the test of time, and everything will be okay as long as you market that brand effectively. I'm a fan of the Six Finger Media logo that I created. That's my logo, and my brand is surrounded by me and what that logo represents. And a good brand does represent something. For me, my logo represents an open hand for those who need help, and the six finger aspect represents awareness of self and situation, because of the whole reality check thing. But then again, the White Hand of Saruman was pretty evil and very similar. The last point I need to make in this video series is remain a good person. The whole idea of this YouTube mini series was to make videos on how to become a good YouTuber, not just a YouTuber who is successful, but a good YouTuber. Not just about how to create content that is good, but it's how to remain good in that content. You need to spread the message of being good without explicitly saying it. You don't need to go out and say, oh, be good. You just need to lead by example. If you're good, other people will follow. In a nutshell, don't be a douche. Okay, thank you very much if you are watching till the end of this video. And thank you very much for all of you who have been watching the video series from the off. The sun is setting, and I think that's very apt for the video coming to a close. Let me know if you enjoyed it, and let me know if there's anything you want to know specifically about being a YouTuber that I didn't cover in this video series. Again, thank you very much to all the Patreon supporters and the YouTube members, and I will see you again for another video back here tomorrow. And until then,